think you guys are on good behavior. All I had to do was walk up and everyone. Today I got a workout coming. Can everybody hear me okay? Okay, sorry about that little screech. We were putting in a different microphone so we don't get the shuffles and things on it. And it was a little bit too much gain. So anybody else that had hearing aids, I apologize for blowing your ears off. So good morning and welcome to the Lord's house. For those who may not know me, I'm Pastor Dan Worcester, emeritus, supposedly. I'm your circuit visitor, and what that means is when there's a vacancy, I'm the one who has to come up and fill pulpits and lead you through the call process and all that other kind of stuff. So I'll be talking to you also during your voters meeting today as we talk about the process itself and giving the elders the right to do some things, which Brad will probably get into in a couple minutes.
Good morning, everybody. Another beautiful day in paradise here in Sandpoint, Idaho. So I just have a couple quick announcements here. We have our duty roster. Okay, if you feel the call, even if you don't feel the call, go and look at the duty roster. Okay, we need help with coffee hour, mowing the lawns, doing the community service, getting that prepped, things like that. So please check that out. It will not be your job for life. Just write down your name on when you can do it, what week you could fill in for that. We have a couple other things coming up. Second harvest, 21 July. You're going to work your butt off, but it's $9 million worth of fun, okay? It's guaranteed to probably be about 140 in the shade. Todd from Second Harvest will be yelling at us, but it's a whole lot of fun. So please sign up for Second Harvest. Fifth Sunday in July, which is going to be July, the fifth Sunday in July, yes. July 30th will be our potluck. We're going to have lunch there, so we're going to have hot dogs, hamburgers, things like that. Come hungry, okay? Come hungry. Today we have our voters meeting right after the service, directly after the service, and thank God for Kessin. She bought so much ice cream and chocolate syrup and nuts and sprinkles. So we're having it again. I'm going to bribe you to stay for the voters meeting, okay? It's worked out pretty good. Today, your homework is due. If you don't have it, we ask that you get it done as soon as you can. But we're asking you to fill out the pastor trace for our call process. We have more blank ones here. Just circle the top 10 traits you're looking for in a pastor you think would be best for Christ our Redeemer. This isn't a vote. What this is we're trying to get a feel of what type of pastor you would like to have for Christ our Redeemer. Right? Put them all together, tally it up, and then take the top 10 traits, and that's what we're going to use during the call process. We have a gray box right back in the narthex. Fill it out. You can put your name on it or not. Slide it in the box, okay? Husbands and wives, you don't have to fill it out together, okay? You might have different opinions. My wife's opinions aren't the same as mine, I can tell you that, right, babe? So, fill those out, put those away. We also have our nomination for consideration for pastors. If you have a pastor in another congregation or if there's one that you know of, you can fill this out. Please, we're asking that you know this person and that you call them ahead of time, okay? We don't want YouTube pastors, because we have to track them all down. We want to make sure that you know this person and that you call them ahead of time to see if they're actually interested in possibly taking a call for Christ our Redeemer. And last one I've got is the call process checklist. If you didn't have that, so you can follow along. Today we're doing our voters meeting to authorize the voters or authorize the elders to call a call. Am I saying that right, Sean? Okay. Close enough? Okay. And last one I have is while we're having ice cream after the voters meeting, Ron Book would like to talk with anybody that's interested in, we used to have our big cross up here that was there for 30 years and it fell down. We'd like to get another one going there. It's just a brainstorming session at this point. What are we looking for? What would we like to see? Something like that. So while we're eating ice cream, go on over and see Ron. He's going to help out with that. So that's everything I got. Thank you, Pastor.
and visitors today and pray the Lord's blessing upon you. And so let us rise for prayer. Lord God, Heavenly Father, as we come before you this morning, we thank and praise you for the gift of this day, a day in which you have promised through the blood of our Lord Jesus Christ that you will guide us and direct us, and that you will give us all that we need to support our body and life. And so we come today to praise you for keeping your promises. So bless us with your spirit as we raise your name on high. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. So let us begin then with praise to the Lord the Almighty.
Thank you.
sin and brokenness at the feet of our loving and forgiving Lord.
We confess that we have sinned against God, our Creator, and that we have sinned against the people around us. By unkind words we have spoken, and by loving actions we have done.
Jesus came into the world and obeyed God's law perfectly for you and for me. He died on the cross for the guilt of our sins, and because of his great sacrifice, you are forgiven. In the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Amen.
Heavenly Father, as we come before you this day, we thank and praise you for the forgiveness of sins that Christ won for us, so that we can stand before you today, not in fear and trembling, but rather in joy and thanksgiving, that we are your children, and you are our Father and our God. In Jesus' name we pray.
Amen.
You may be seated as we hear the word of the Lord.
Good morning. Can you hear me? This morning's first lesson is from Exodus chapter 6, starting at verse 1. Then the Lord said to Moses, "Now you will see what I will do to Pharaoh. Because of my mighty hand, he will let them go. Because of my mighty hand, he will drive them out of his country." God also said to Moses, "I am the Lord. I appeared to Abraham, to Isaac, and to Jacob as God Almighty. But by my name, the Lord, I did not make myself fully known to them. I also established my covenant with them to give them the land of Canaan, where they resided as foreigners. Moreover, I have heard the groaning of the Israelites, whom the Egyptians were enslaving, and I have remembered my covenant. Therefore, say to the Israelites, I am the Lord, and I will bring you out from under the yoke of the Egyptians. I will free you from being slaves to them, and I will redeem you with an outstretched arm and with mighty acts of judgment. I will take you as my own people, and I will be your God. Then you will know that I am the Lord your God, who brought you out from under the yoke of the Egyptians. And I will bring you to the land I swore with uplifted hand to give to Abraham, to Isaac, and to Jacob. I will give it to you as a possession. I am the Lord." Moses reported this to the Israelites, but they did not listen to him because of their discouragement and harsh labor. Then the Lord said to Moses, "Go, tell Pharaoh, king of Egypt, to let the Israelites go out of his country." But Moses said to the Lord, "If the Israelites will not listen to me, why would Pharaoh listen to me, since I am speaking and I speak with faltering lips?" Now the Lord spoke to Moses and Aaron about the Israelites and Pharaoh, king of Egypt, and he commanded them to bring the Israelites out of Egypt. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Our epistle lesson is from Romans, chapter 11, verse 33. "Oh, the depth of the riches of the wisdom and knowledge of God, how unsearchable his judgments and his paths beyond tracing out. Who has known the mind of the Lord, or who has been his counselor? Who has ever given to God that God should repay them? For from him, and through him, and for him are all things. To him be the glory forever. Amen." This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Let us rise for the reading of the Holy Gospel. The Holy Gospel is recorded in Matthew chapter 16, verses 13 to 20. And when Jesus came to the region of Caesarea Philippi, he asked his disciples, "Who do people say the Son of Man is?" They replied, "Some say John the Baptist, others say Elijah, and still others, Jeremiah or one of the prophets." "But what about you?" he asked. "Who do you say I am?" Simon Peter answered, "You are the Messiah, the Son of the living God." Jesus replied, "Blessed are you, Simon, son of Jonah, for this was not revealed to you by flesh and blood, but by my Father in heaven. And I tell you that you are Peter, and on this rock I will build my church, and the gates of Hades will not overcome it. I will give you the keys of the kingdom of heaven. Whatever you bind on earth will be bound in heaven, and whatever you loose on earth will be loosed in heaven. And And then he ordered his disciples not to tell anyone that he was the Messiah. This is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
We join together as a family in Christ and confess our holy Christian faith in the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. And the third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
You may be seated. We continue with our children.
Else that other people could do.
Okay, that's that's a good start, but that's not why he came.
Oh, he came to die for our sins.
Okay, which means what about our sins? They're paid for, they're forgiven, aren't they?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, Jesus is our Savior. He saved us from sin, our own self-centeredness, the devil. When we're tempted to do evil, he's stronger than the devil. And he came to give us eternal life through the forgiveness of our sins, didn't he? And he could do that because he was who?
The Son.
The Son of God. Yeah. See, we start out knowing a little bit about this today, and you'll learn more. We start out knowing that Jesus came to save us, but we've got to keep growing in that. We've got to understand who Jesus really is. And that's why he asked his disciples. Because if it wasn't too much longer, Jesus was going to be on the cross paying for our sins. And his disciples were going to be the ones telling others about who Jesus is after he rose from the dead. What's our job today?
To tell others about Jesus.
So it's helpful if we know who he is, isn't it? Not just that he came as Messiah, Son of God, but what that means to you every day of your life. So we're going to talk a little bit about that in the bigger sermon today as Moses and God have a conversation. But it's important to continue to grow in your knowledge of who Jesus is. And how do you do that?
To learn from God.
You'll learn from God. That means you've got to talk to him, don't you?
Yeah.
That means reading his word.
Yep.
Prayer.
Mm-hmm.
And being honest with him.
Mm-hmm.
You guys ever hide anything from your parents?
No.
No. Later on, and the kids are talking about what they used to do when they were little, the parents look over and say, I never knew that.
Yeah.
And all of a sudden the cat's out of the bag, but it doesn't hurt anything because that's a long time ago. And they have continued to love you anyhow. Remember, that's the same way about God.
Anyways,
he knows what's in your heart. He knows what's in our hearts even before we speak it. And so you can go to God with anything that's on your mind and in your heart, and he will listen to you. And he promises to forgive where we have done wrong, and he promises to strengthen us where we need his strength. How do you know that promise is true?
Because he died on the cross.
Because Jesus died for us. That's exactly right. And rose again. He didn't stay dead. He rose again. And he lives right here. So let's have a prayer. Lord God, Heavenly Father, we thank you that you love us so much, that you gave your Son, who gave up his life, so that we can know you as a loving God. We ask that as we live out our life this week, that we would bring all our concerns, our joys, and our hopes to you, because you promised to listen to us, and you've always promised to answer. Help us to receive those answers as your will. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Thanks for coming up, guys.
All right. Is this last?
Thank you.
the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. The text for this morning is the Old Testament lesson for today. As God speaks to Moses, then the Lord said to Moses, "Now you will see what I will do to Pharaoh. Because of my mighty hand, he will let them go. Because of my mighty hand, he will drive them out of his country." God also said to Moses, "I am the Lord. I appeared to Abraham, to Isaac, to Jacob, as God Almighty. But by my name, the Lord, I did not make myself fully known to them. I also established my covenant with them to give them the land of Canaan, where they resided as foreigners. Moreover, I have heard the groaning of the Israelites, whom the Egyptians are enslaving, and I have remembered my covenant. Therefore say to the Israelites, I am the Lord. I will bring you out from under the yoke of the Egyptians. I will free you from being slaves to them, and I will redeem you with an outstretched arm and a mighty axe of judgment. And I will take you as my own people, and I will be your God. Then you will know that I am the Lord your God, who brought you out from under the yoke of the Egyptians, and I will bring you to the land I swore with uplifted hand to give you to Abraham, to Isaac, to Jacob. I will give it to you as a possession. I am the Lord." Now Moses reported this to the Israelites, but they did not listen to him because of their discouragement and harsh labor. Then the Lord said to Moses, "Go tell Pharaoh, the king of Egypt, to let the Israelites go out of his country." But Moses said to the Lord, "If the Israelites will not listen to me, why would Pharaoh listen to me, since I speak with faltering lips?" But the Lord spoke to Moses and Aaron about the Israelites and Pharaoh, the king of Egypt, and he commanded them to bring the Israelites out of Egypt. Have you ever been in a situation in which you looked at it and you said, it's hopeless? There's just no way out of it. There's just too many things going against us in order to make this happen. Ever been there? We get discouraged, don't we? And we kind of look at it and say, I think I'll just give up. Or sometimes we even go further and we say, where is God at in all this? Where is he? He's supposed to take care of me. I've been praying to him, and he hasn't answered my prayer. Has he forgotten me? Those thoughts run through our heads sometimes, don't they? Well, guess what? This morning we're going to look at a conversation between God and Moses. That's called prayer. Because prayer isn't just a one-way street. Some people will define it as, I prayed, I'm speaking to God. What happens when you speak to your children? Or your parents used to speak to you? Was it a two-way street? Nope. It was, this is what you're going to do. Or get to your room, or clean your room. Or where were you last night at 11 and your curfew was at 10? Or how come we spent this much in a checkbook this week? It's a one-way street. Prayer is a conversation with God. It goes both ways. We can call upon God and we speak to him, and then we need to stop and listen to the answer that he's given us. So let's take a look at this. Why was Moses kind of upset with God? Well, what happened the first thing? Moses took off for Egypt finally when he got Aaron up alongside him. And they went down to see Pharaoh and they did these signs that God gave him. I thought, Moses probably said, man, this is pretty good. Take a stick, throw it down, turns into a snake, pick it back up. Pretty good. Put your hand here, pull it out, leprosy, put it back. Man, that ought to be impressive to Pharaoh and to the people of Israel, and it was to the people of Israel. It said that they fell down and worshiped God. That was pretty neat. But then he goes in and sees Pharaoh. And And Pharaoh said, I never heard of this God of Israel. He's nobody to me. And I have the biggest army. And I am the sun god called Re. I sit on his throne. I represent him. Nobody tells me what to do, especially this God you talk about. And he got a little bit offended, and he calls in his workers or his taskmasters, and he says, this guy Moses thinks he's pretty sharp, and his God's really strong. He says, those Israelites have too much time on their hand. We're going to increase their labor because they're making bricks for Pharaoh. And he says, remember you used to bring straw to them? Now they have to go find their own. And they still have to do the same number of bricks they used to. How would you like it if your boss walked in and said, I'm cutting your pay in half, but I expect the same product production and the same number of hours you've been working all the time. And there's no lunch breaks. People of Israel got a little bit upset. And their taskmasters are saying, we're in big trouble. What's going to happen next, Moses? And it's all because of you walking in there and causing Pharaoh to get upset with us. Where is this God of Israel? And so Moses goes out and he calls upon God. And he says, you know, God, you told me you're going to deliver them. What have you been doing? I did what you told me. And now my people are turning against me. What am I going to do? And God kind of looks at Moses. And he doesn't answer his question. Did you catch that? He doesn't say, well, just hang in there, Moses. Things will get better. No. What does he say? He says, then the Lord said to Moses, now you will see what I will do to Pharaoh. Because of my mighty hand, he will let them go. Because of my mighty hand, he will drive them out of his country. He looks at Moses and he says, the fun's only beginning. Pharaoh thinks he is the strong one. There will be a day he will plead with me and tell you guys to get out of here because he's had enough. God told Moses that earlier in the chapter prior. He says, when you go see Pharaoh, Moses, he's not going to listen to you. But you tell him, if you hurt Israel, I will kill your firstborn. And that didn't dent Pharaoh. But Moses knew that was going to happen. Did you ever have that happen in life? When you're praying to God, but you already kind of know the outcome because you've been there before? But you forgot about it because God delivered you once other time, maybe. I don't know about you, but in my life, I can count 5 times I shouldn't be here. I should have been pushing up daisies a long time ago. But he decided to keep me around through no great ability of mine whatsoever. I can share one with you. We were climbing Glacier Peak over in Washington, Cascades. We were way up at the top, beautiful place. But as we were starting our way down, we came across a bridge, a saddle, and all of a sudden my clamp-ons, because it was snow, they let go. And I went scooting down that mountainside. And at that point, with pack and all, probably weighed about 270 pounds. On the other end of the rope was a guy rigging wet, weighed about 170. And we're heading straight for the edge. He's sitting there going, what am I going to do? If he go goes over the edge, we all go over the edge. He was about ready to jump off the other side when from here to that rail, I stopped. What do you say except thank you? Because there was no reason to stop. And in between us was a teenager who was sweating bullets because he didn't know what was going to happen. All we could say is the Lord has delivered us. And I think if you look back over your life, there's places where the Lord has delivered you. And all you could do was say thank you. And so God tells Moses, I'm not going to explain myself to you, but this is what's going to happen. Pharaoh and I are going to be at war with each other. It's not just between Pharaoh and Moses, it's between gods. The sun god Re, that the Egyptians thought was the most powerful god in the world, and the God of Israel, who gave Moses his name of what? Yahweh. I am who I am. I'm above all other gods. There is no god but me. He's the Almighty God because what did he do for Abraham? He gave him a son when it was almost impossible. And Isaac and Jacob, he kept on leading them along the way and made promises to them and gave them a covenant. But he had never shown himself the way he's going to show himself to the Egyptians. He's going to fight for Israel. What does he say? He said, I've heard their groanings, and I have come to set them free. He's going up against the mightiest king in the world at that time. And he says, Pharaoh's going to beg me to let your people go. Wow. What a statement. What's it based on? It's based on a relationship that God had made with Abraham and Isaac and Jacob. A covenant, he said, I swore that I would bring them and I would give them the land and they would be a great people. And he told Abraham, by you nations will be blessed. And he left children as many as the stars in the sky when it seemed almost impossible. But Moses is saying, explain yourself, God. And God says, Moses, you got it backwards. You explain yourself to me, and I will fulfill my promises. Do we sometimes do that in our prayer life? God, explain yourself to me. Tell me why this is going on. I don't understand it. I can't see it. What does Romans say? Who has been God's counselor? Remember Job? He said the same thing. He said, God, explain yourself. And God says, who darkens my door? With a lack of understanding. And he takes Job through a whole list. Can you do this? Can you make the mountains tremble? Can you know this? Can you know that? Can you sink the Leviathan and put him down in the sea? Can you do that, Job? And Job says, okay, I'm sorry. I spoke out of turn. You are God. And you can do with me as you want. And what did God do? Replenished him sevenfold over what he had lost because he understood the relationship. Moses is there saying, explain yourself just like we do. Because why? He says, darn it, it's uncomfortable. My people won't listen to me. And you're telling me I got to go talk to Pharaoh and then I got to go talk to them and I'm supposed to take them out of this place? And he says, you got it all wrong, Moses. What does he say? He says, therefore say to Israel, I am the Lord. I will bring you out from under the yoke of the Egyptians. I will free you from being slaves to them. I will redeem you with outstretched arm and mighty acts of judgment. I will take you as my own people, and I will be your God. And then you will know that I am the Lord your God, who brought you out from under the yoke of the Egyptians, and I will bring you to the land I swore with a lifted hand to give to Abraham, to Isaac, and to Jacob. I will give it to you as a possession. I am the Lord. Who's the actor? Who's the warrior? It's God. He says, I keep my promises, and I'm going to do what I said. Just hang in there with me, Moses. Just hang in there. Because what does it say at the end? And God talked to Moses and Aaron and commanded them to bring Israel out of Egypt. He says, this is as if you want to, Moses. This is what I'm going to do, and I need you to lead them. He did the promise of hearing. Should it surprise us when we have troubles? When we think we don't understand what's going on? But yeah, we get frustrated. And you know something? It's okay. It's okay to walk into God's presence and tell Him those frustrations. Tell Him we don't understand. Ask Him for clarity. But don't ask Him to explain Himself. He's much bigger than you and I are. But He says, I'll ask you to take a look at something. Did I promise to send a Savior? Yes, He did. And He sent Him to us in Jesus Christ. He said, did I promise to give you power over sin? Yes, we have it. It's called confession. And in the name of Jesus, we are forgiven. So it doesn't separate us from our God. And we start looking other places to find that love that we need or the relationship that we desire. It's right there in our hearts. It's right there in the people that God has put around us. We just have to value it. Did He promise us that we'd have victory over death? He didn't say, I'm going to take it away. This world would be mighty crowded if He did that, at least now. He says, the wages of sin is death. That's still there, because we still sin. But He said, I did promise you eternal life. I did promise that death cannot separate us. I proved that in Jesus Christ. He says, look at those things. And have I not provided for you in the past? Our best eyesight is hindsight. We can see what He's done. And He says, I will continue to do that because you are heading for a land that I swore to you. It's the kingdom of God. It's His presence. It's there forever. And no matter what happens along the way, He says, I will never leave you nor desert you. He told His disciples, He says, I'm ascending into heaven, but I will not leave you as an orphan. I will send forth my Spirit who will teach you all that I have taught you. To remind us that He's right here and right here. That's the beauty of God. He keeps His promises. And He says, all we have to do is look to those. And Moses had to look to that time and time and time again. Because he went out and told the people, he said, I've talked with the only God. And we're going to see Him do great things. And what did they say? To you, Moses. We don't believe it, but what happened? We all know the rest of the story. And you're going to look at it in the weeks to come. Pharaoh finally said, get these people out of here. And Pharaoh met his match in the Red Sea. But that didn't stop the people from forgetting. And Moses had to keep reminding. And Moses had to keep talking with God. Because he too was stressed out. And he needed to look at that promise just as much as his people. Things haven't changed. The promise of God today is we are forgiven through His body and blood. So just a few minutes. We are established in a covenant that He has made with us through His body and blood. That he that believeth in me, even though he die, yet he shall live. Whoever sins you, you remit, they are remitted, they're forgiven. Whoever sins you retain, they are retained. He says, I will take care of you. Your Father in heaven knows when a sparrow hops on the ground, and how many hairs are on your head or not on your head. That's how much he loves you. He says, remember that. And continue to go forward, trusting in the only God. He is the only God who's ever overcome death. He is the only God who created the heavens and the earth. And he is our Father who is in heaven. In Jesus' name. Thank you. creation that you have so wondrously made. And all it takes is one storm to wipe out a lot of things that man has done. All it takes is one tremor of the earth, just a twitch of your little finger, and we realize how powerless we really are. But we thank you that we also have seen your mercy. You heard our cries. Our cries for forgiveness, our cries for your love, our cries to overcome death and the grave. And you sent forth your Son, Jesus Christ, so that we can be set free. Set free not to do anything we want, but set free to do your will and to love others in your name and to be able to show them who Christ really is. He is your Son who gave up his life so that we may have life. Lord, in your mercy. And Father, we come before you today with requests, asking for you to be with others, be with Todd and Troy. We ask for health and happiness for them, and John and Gail, and Joe for recovery from his hip surgery, for Jason for a strong heart. Not only that it keeps beating strongly, but also a heart that doesn't know how to give up, but rests in you for its strength. For the Bird family, for their faith, that may we increase their faith and give them joy. For Randy and Jody, for helping their new jobs, give them the wisdom to be able to take on a new challenge and a heart to be a servant. For Wilma, for health and joy. We remember this morning Pastor Steve as he starts a brand new ministry in Covington. We ask, Father, that you would bless him with your spirit and guide him and direct him so that as your servant he can meet the needs of a new congregation and lead them to a greater faith in you and a love towards one another. And for Sarah and for health and strength. Father, there's a lot of the petitions that we have and hold in our hearts that we now lay before you, whether they be frustrations or joys or needs. You promised to hear them, and so we lay them before you now in a moment of silence. Father, we know that you hear our prayers, and so we ask that you would answer them according to your holy will, and give us eyes to see, ears to hear, hearts willing to receive what that will is. We may not understand it now, but you promise that you will work all things for the good of those who love you and are called according to your purpose. We thank you, Father, that you have put men and women who are willing to risk their lives to keep us free, to keep us safe. In the military, in the police forces, in the health professions, Father, we thank you for them. Lord, in your mercy. And so, Father, we thank you for hearing us. We await your answers in the name of Jesus. Amen. As we come before our Lord today, he keeps his promises. He promises that through the bread and wine, simple elements, he comes to us in his body and blood to assure us of the forgiveness of our sins because we take that bread and wine, his body and blood, into ourselves. It's for you and nobody else when we receive that. But that unites us together as one people, for he has called us out and made us his people through Christ's death and resurrection. So as brothers and sisters in Christ, we prepare our hearts to receive the body and blood of our Lord. And the night on which he was betrayed, he took some bread, and he broke it, and he blessed it, and he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is broken for you." In the same way also, he took a cup after he had eaten it, when he had given thanks, and he blessed it, and he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Drink of it, all of you. This cup is the New Testament in my blood, which is shed for you for the forgiveness of sins. This do as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. As often as we eat this bread and drink this cup, we proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And also with you.
We join together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
The feast is prepared. Let us
Savior Jesus Christ, strengthen and preserve you in true faith unto life everlasting. Go, knowing that your sins have been forgiven, and serve the Lord in his peace and in his joy. Amen. Heavenly Father, we thank you for enriching us with this joyful feast and empowering us to be your children, not on our merit, but through the merits of our Lord Jesus Christ. And so we ask that it may strengthen us in our faith towards you and our love towards one another. In Jesus' name we pray.
Amen.
And as we go out as God's people into his world, remember, he keeps his promises. We are his people. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious unto you. And the Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you his peace. Amen. We continue with Here I Am, Lord.
Thank you.
take a 5-minute break and we get everybody back in, and then after the meeting, we'll serve the ice cream if that works.
Oh, that works.
Okay.
Sounds good.
So what? Everybody will smoke them if you got them. Back in. And so we're gonna hold you to a quick 5, okay? So please come back in. We'll take care of our voters meeting. Also, too, please, while you're taking your break, pick up an agenda and
that's what you call making decisions on the fly. So with that in mind, don't go too far, but go in peace and serve the Lord.